In today's episode, I'm going to take a look at this $99 Easythreed X1 printer. $99, is it any good? Well, we'll find out on today's Filament Friday. Filament Friday is brought to you by these Patreon supporters. This is the $99 X1 3D printer from Easythreed. And I got this from banggood.com. They sell it for $99. They gave it to me to do a review. And honestly, it's got some features that I like. I don't expect to get a lot from a $99 printer, especially when it's made of plastic and just kind of looks cheap. But it comes mostly assembled, the top half and the bottom half with the electronics. So you snap this top section in, tighten two screws, and make one electrical connection, and then snap together their spool holder, and it goes on two screws in the back, and it's assembled. Now, there are full instructions on the SD card, and also they have their own slicer called EasyWare. It's actually just based on the Cura slicing engine, but I like it. It's really easy to use. They do give you some sample PLA, although I ended up using my own spool. They give you a screwdriver to tighten the two screws, and also to help adjust the bed. The bed itself has a removable magnetic plate, and it does have belts at all corners, including the Z-axis, which makes that first layer kind of squish, and it's harder to get a consistent level bed. It's one drawback, but that's what you get with a $99 printer. They do give you a single sheet of instructions, which are very, very limited. Again, the full instructions are on the SD card, but this thing's really good for leveling the bed. They also give you a power adapter. This is what powers the whole thing. It's a 12-volt, 2.5-amp adapter, and it plugs into the box. Now, there's no on-off switch, so plugging or unplugging the power adapter is how you turn it on and off. There is a USB connection, and they give you a USB cable for that. I was able to connect to it through Pronterface and verified it is running Marlin, although an old version, 1.1.0. So it's pretty old. I think that goes back to 2015. There is a micro SD card, and there is a sample print on the SD card here. There's no LCD or control knob on this, so it's going to print whatever the newest file that's on the SD card. That's how it determines what to print, because there's only four controls. There's a home button that only homes the Z. There's a plus and minus for loading and unloading the filament. And then there's a play button, and it's multifunction. You use that button to start a print, to pause a print, to stop a print, and also you hold it for 3 seconds, and it'll raise the Z 10 millimeters. So everything is done just through these buttons. So it's really, really basic. They do offer an X2 version, which has LCD and knob. I think it's like $30 more than this. So it's $129. So everything is based on the date code of your file. I did take it apart and verified it's got the same setup as an Ender 3. It's got a 1284 microcontroller and it's got 4988 drivers. There is some form of thermal runaway protection. I tested it, and it will shut off the hot end if it loses track of the temperature. So there is some protection built into the Marlin firmware. I did load up the sample file. It's a CAT. It printed pretty good. I mean, it didn't fail or nothing, but at the end of it, look at the print quality. It's pretty bad. And it did print on a raft, and I know why, because this bed, it's really difficult to keep it leveled. So next, I decided to try out their slicer, EasyWare, and try out my CHEP cube. So let's take a look at that. So I opened it up from the SD card. The first thing you need to do is select English, then you select your printer, then you select PLA. And it opens to this really cool looking window. It's very clean. You've got an import, a save, a delete, and a slice button. And the slice button has two modes. A button mode where fast, standard, and optimize, you know, one click. Or you can go custom, where you get all the Cura settings. Well, not all of them, but a lot of them, most of the important ones. So you can scroll through them here. So now let's import my CHEP cube. So I click on the import button here, go find it, click on it, and just select choose, and it should land on the bed. And there it is. Now, once it's on the bed, I can zoom in, zoom out. I can scroll this thing around. There's controls down here where I can look at the top. I can look at the side. I can look at the flank, or I can reset it back to where it was. If I click on it, I can move it around, I can rotate it, and I can actually put a degrees in there. I can scale it, and also with the uniform scale, just like Cura. But then it's got floor here, and this is where you select a side, and that side will go to the base.
That's something that was added to Cura really late. So this is a nice feature. So you can set which side you want on the bed. So now let's slice this and take a look at it. So I'll click on custom and I'm going to use just their standard settings right here. But I did notice it defaults to 180 degrees C. That's something you're going to want to change because most filaments need higher temperature. So I sliced it with their default settings here and it automatically goes to preview mode. And you can scroll through the layers. This is something you have to click separately in Cura. And it really does a good job of showing. I mean, it's not perfect, but it does a good job of showing the different layers and how it looks. Once you got it sliced, you're ready to save it to the SD card. You have two options. You can just click on Save SD Card, or you can save data, which means you can put it anywhere in your hard drive, or you can go find your SD card and save it to there. So two different ways, very similar to what Cura has. So now that we got this, I actually re-sliced it with a skirt, no raft, and tried to print it directly on the bed. Let's look at that.
Here's a time lapse of it printing, and if you watch closely, you can see it warped. It lifted right off the bed and warped. It's not a heated bed, so this thing warped terrible. It's really a worse print than the CAT. And if you notice, the CHEP is backwards. It's a mirror image. It's because the Y-axis motor is reversed. It's actually moving in the wrong direction. So then I was ready to just shove this aside and say it's a piece of crap. I don't recommend it. But then I realized it's direct drive. And when I saw the internal workings, it actually traps the filament similar to the way the EZR extruder does on my Ender 3. So I wondered, could it print that really flexible stuff like NinjaFlex? So I tried it. So I took the same CHEP cube file, printed it without a raft, and it stuck to the bed really well because that's what this filament does. And it actually came out a little bit smoother because this filament doesn't give you those crisp edges. And look at, it's flexible. I can squeeze it. Next, I tried printing a rubber foot from my Ender 3. I put this on all my Enders, makes them a little quieter. This thing is squishy. It printed really well. The base of it where it touched the bed is a little bit rough, but the rest of it looks really good. I'm really impressed with how well this thing prints NinjaFlex. This is very handy, and there's no stringing. In between these feet on my Ender 3 with the EZR, I get a little bit of stringing between the feet. There's no stringing here, none at all. So I've printed a few more flexible prints, and they're all coming out good. I've never had a single one fail. And this thing just, I don't know, it just prints flexible so well, and PLA is so average, that to me, it's a great flexible printer. That's what it's good for. And if you want to use this with kids, it makes more sense to have them print flexible materials because if they printed blocks and then they start throwing blocks at each other, the PLA is going to hurt. If you hit yourself with one of these soft ones, it's going to hurt a lot less. And there's so many other things you could do with this. Now, when I was a kid, there were machines to make what they called creepy crawlies. They're creepy crawly machines. They're really just a molding machine where you could print flexible little snakes and lizards. This is like a modern day creepy crawly machine. You put some flexible filament in it and you can print pretty much any flexible you want. And as far as the bed level, who cares? This stuff sticks so well. If your bed's off a little bit, so what? So I decided to make a creepy crawly. I found this lizard on Thingiverse. I printed it out and look at this. It printed it beautifully. And this thing's totally flexible. So from that point of view, I think this is a fantastic $99 investment. Just print NinjaFlex with it. And then a kid could have a ton of fun with this. And as far as settings, I didn't do any different settings than the PLA. The same settings to print the PLA as the NinjaFlex, and it worked beautifully. So I don't have to do anything special. To hold the larger spool, I did make a new bracket, designed this in Tinkercad, printed it on my CR10. It's too big for this machine, but it just slides right on. Locks in place and holds the larger spool. So I'm sure there'll be better designs in the future as people get these machines, but this is really incredible what this thing can do with flexibles. So this, to me, is a modern day creepy crawly machine. It's perfect for kids to make rubberized or flexible toys. If you like what I'm doing here, please subscribe. There's other videos that should be popping up, but most of all, stay safe through this tough time we're going through, and I'll see you next time right here at Filament Friday.